Local programming on KRWG Public Media made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Your Legislators, a production of KRWG Public Media. Your Legislators is a public service program providing our viewing audience in southern New Mexico the opportunity to hear about important legislative issues directly from their elected representatives in Santa Fe.
Hello and welcome to Your Legislators here on KRWG Public Media. I'm your host, Anthony Moreno. Joining us is District 36 Democratic State Senator Jeff Steinborn. He joins us from Santa Fe to talk about issues facing his district and the state. Senator Steinborn, thank you so much for making time to join us here.
You're welcome. Good morning. Good to be with you, Anthony.
Now, it's been an exciting week. I'd like to talk with you about legislation you've been involved with for some time that is aiming to establish an outdoor recreation office. I know there's been some news about an equity fund as well. Can you share with us the news?
I will. For 2 years now, I've been working to kind of bring to New Mexico this idea that some other Western states have adopted to create an actual office of outdoor recreation. And in the state of New Mexico, the outdoor recreation industry brings $9.9 billion of spending into the state. And just an incredible source of jobs and tourism to take advantage of New Mexico's incredible landscapes and culture. And when Governor Lujan Grisham was running for office and the other candidates, I spoke to them about this idea. She instantly jumped on it, was campaigning on it, and was thrilled to see that after she got elected, she wanted to aggressively move forward on it. And of course, I've been working on legislation with some of my colleagues since before the new year that would set up an actual Office of Outdoor Recreation. As a part of this legislation, we have a very neat concept called an Outdoor Equity Fund that would help get disadvantaged kids outdoors so that they could take advantage of our public lands too, and also help the next generation of New Mexicans understand the value and the importance of our lands, of stewardship, and to hopefully help protect them and lead the way moving forward. So it's a really exciting bill. Folks can see it on my legislative webpage at nmlegis.gov. Just go to my page for Senator Steinborn and they can read all about the bill. It's very exciting and it was a fun day announcing it. That morning I actually rode from the governor's mansion with the governor and two of her cabinet secretaries to the Capitol on our bikes and just to kick off celebrating outdoor recreation. It was a beautiful day, no one got hurt, and it was a special moment.
So can you share with us a little bit more details, really, about the office, what it will look like, how
Sure.
it will be staffed, things like that?
Sure. So what the bill would do in the legislation is it would create a division, actually, in the Economic Development Department of the state government. So it would create the New Mexico Outdoor Recreation Division. We're seeking funding that would basically hire a staff of 5 to 6 folks who would, in their mission, and this is spelled out in the bill, would be to promote New Mexico's outdoor recreation brand, to help grow small businesses related to outdoor recreation, to help attract to the state outdoor recreation manufacturers to try to grow a business cluster of these companies, and then also to help communities around the state tap into funding sources that exist to grow outdoor recreation infrastructure, whether that's a trail or some other kind of outdoor amenity. It could be, I suppose it could be a visitor center outside. But basically, help us grow our assets related to outdoor recreation and then promote those assets and grow businesses all over the state. And I think very important to help showcase all of our great communities and natural areas around the state that exist from the Oregon Mountain Desert Peaks in Las Cruces and the new Rio Grande Trail, all the way to the Rio Grande del Norte Monument and the Three Rivers area in Farmington and all points in between. So also there's a component of the legislation that should any of our tribal governments, who are of course sovereign nations, want to work with the state of New Mexico on this, then we will work through existing legal authority that framework for how we work together with our sovereign nation tribe partners, and then work in conjunction with the tribes as well. So that's what it would do. And hopefully we can pass this bill and get the requisite funding that we really need to make it be all that we want it to be. And it would go into effect this year, soon.
Well, it sounds really exciting. Obviously, there's been a lot of excitement here in Las Cruces with the establishment of the Oregon Mountains Desert Peaks National Monument. We've seen some local businesses use that as a tool to really draw in more business to them. Is that something that really kind of inspired you to push this legislation after seeing what happened here in Las Cruces?
Definitely. Absolutely. My experience working not only helping to create the Oregon Mountain Desert Peaks Monument, but the Rio Grande Trail as well, and seeing firsthand the impact of growing outdoor recreation has clearly shown that we can create good jobs from protected public lands and from sharing those areas with the world. And we've seen it in Las Cruces with great companies like Oregon Mountain Outfitters that are now having their brand shown all across the world. And Chris Lang, who's an amazing entrepreneur, has talked about how the monument inspired the creation of that brand. And then it just goes on and on and all over the state. So, it's big business. And again, at $9.9 billion, according to the Outdoor Industry Association, is the impact of outdoor recreation to the state of New Mexico. And while that's a very big number, it actually is the smallest number of all western states around us. Colorado has a $22 billion outdoor recreation impact, and they have an outdoor office. Utah is $14 billion. Arizona, also north of us. So it's people want to live, work, and play in places with high quality of life. And so, it's just a really smart thing for us to do. And also, it's a smart thing for us to establish our brand as a state that way because, again, people want to locate businesses in those kinds of communities as well. So it's just good all the way around. It's a win-win.
Well, I want to talk a little bit more about that. I mean, you say it's a smart thing to do, but I kind of wonder about, is it the sustainable thing to do? Because the establishment of this office, obviously, down the road in the future, there could be a new administration that may not share these same interests as well. So they could probably get rid of the office. Is that possible?
Sure, they could, unless it's rooted in the Constitution, and we can even change that. Anything can change in the future. We will get out of it what we put into it, frankly. And it's really important that setting it up is one thing. Doing a great job running it and deploying it and executing the vision of it is something different. And to the extent that it is a very successful venture and establishes a really great brand for the state and shows a lot of success, then I think a new administration will want to just continue to embrace it. And I think their constituents will demand that of them. This effort to create the outdoor office is a bipartisan initiative. There's elected officials on both sides of the aisle in both chambers who are supportive of it. We've seen communities all over the state, from quote conservative communities to more progressive communities, want to develop their outdoor economies because it's one thing all New Mexicans share, aside from green chili, that we love, and that's our outdoors. So this will be what we make of it, and hopefully it will become an important part of our state's outreach and brand moving forward.
Now, one of the things that Governor Lujan Grisham has stated is that she wants to invest heavily in film. I know you have been heavily involved in the establishment of film here in Las Cruces with the soundstage and creating and growing the film community. I'd like to hear your thoughts on the governor mentioning that she wants to remove the cap on investing in film with the rebate, I believe it is, for production companies to come here and create films. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, it's an exciting industry to continue to develop and grow in the state. An initiative that I'm working on is how can we help grow more film around outside the Albuquerque-Santa Fe corridor? And we see that the vast majority of production really stays within that zone. And there are reasons for that. And so while I am very supportive of film, growing film, I think it's really important at this moment when we're asking taxpayers and citizens all over the state to give more funding for this, that there is a shared benefit in that. And so what I am trying to do this session, one thing I'm trying to do is adopt a statute that both Louisiana and New York State have done, which are film states that do more film production than New Mexico, and New Mexico is in the top five. So, I mean, there's a few big states in Louisiana, New York, two of them. What they have done is adopt what's called an out-of-zone tax credit to help a film production have a little extra spiff, a little extra rebate if they come film in an underserved film area. And what that really is defined by is areas that don't have a lot of established film crew members, which are all in Albuquerque and Santa Fe. And the reason for the idea is it costs more to bring those crew outside of where they live, which is Albuquerque and Santa Fe, to film in other parts of the state. And as a result, most film productions choose to stay in Albuquerque and Santa Fe. And unless we find a way to help incentivize them to bring those productions outside, then what I'm concerned about is we will continue to grow film, but we will continue to primarily grow it in one part of the state. And so I'm pushing very hard for the inclusion of this. I think it's the right time to do it, like New York and Louisiana did it as they were growing. This is what we can do to grow this industry statewide and have it be a win-win. And having said that, Film Las Cruces is doing an incredible job making a name for the city of Las Cruces in the film industry and building those assets. And we're going to continue to grow our film presence. What we want to do is continue to put us on the best playing field possible and a level playing field with the other production centers of the state, as do other communities around the state. So this is an idea I'm also finding a lot of support for.
Well, that's really exciting. One thing I was concerned about was that the Albuquerque Journal reported in September of 2018 that major film productions were actually down that year and hiring of New Mexico crew members were down as well. So is there any legislation that you are working on that can ensure that people in New Mexico will be hired and possibly, you know, how can we attract even more film production, even though we're doing so well with, you know, I guess, compared to other states?
Sure. So number one, our New Mexico film incentive requires that they use New Mexico labor and New Mexico services in order to get our rebate. There are some exceptions built into that where we allow a certain amount of labor to be brought in to New Mexico as well as services. I think in both those cases, the legislation being looked at would tighten that up. So that'll be a good thing for us because we're growing at a point where we need to be kind of strict about that. And that was one of the smarter things we've done all along the way is require New Mexico-based services so that we grow our crew base, we grow our jobs and technical talents as the film industry grows here. As far as growing film in the state, the incentive program is the reason that films are coming to New Mexico. That and the fact that, of course, we've got a film crew base that's developed here to be able to service them, which is an important factor, cost-effective factor for films. So as we do things or talk about things like raising the cap, pay off some of the backlog of incentive money due, maybe streamline the incentive and make it easier for films, all of these things will make New Mexico a more desirable place to film. And so I think we're on the right track. We just need to continue to think about how do we double our crew? How do we double our infrastructure base? And double, you know, we talk about doubling the film industry in New Mexico. We have to double the infrastructure that supports that and make sure we're doing it in a way that goes statewide. And that is crucial. That is really crucial in a matter of fairness to all New Mexicans who pay for the program. So that is where my 5% out-of-zone tax credit comes in. And I'm hopeful that we will get that included in some final package.
Great. We'll keep updated on that. I'd like to give you a moment right now to kind of inform us on legislation that you are working on that you think is really going to make an impact on your district and the state of New Mexico.
Sure, you bet. I am, if you go to my the website, the New Mexico Legislature website, nmlegis.gov, and you go to my page, I've got, I want to say, 22 pieces of legislation I've introduced on a variety of subjects having to do with everything from healthcare reform to trying to lower the cost of prescription drugs by consolidating all of our state purchasing of prescription drugs, which is about $700 million a year, including for Medicaid, teachers, retirees, and also figuring out how we can leverage the state's massive purchasing power to help people in the private sector who maybe don't have insurance or have a private plan, see if we can leverage that to get people a better deal. So that's one issue I've been working on for a few years. In fact, 2 years ago, I passed that bill, and the governor unfortunately vetoed it and passed the Senate unanimously my first session. So I am working to move that bill. Got other exciting bills on energy. One bill would allow for the first time our community, like Las Cruces, to be able to purchase energy from whoever we want. Right now, we basically are all kind of forced into one monopoly choice on who our energy provider is. And then we're forced to kind of haggle over the terms of that energy and kind of have a fundamental difference of interest when it comes to what citizens need, which is cheap energy and green energy, and what, frankly, those providers want. And they get paid, and they're allowed to get paid based upon the amount of infrastructure they build and power plants they build. And the PRC allows them a rate of return literally on assets. And so through the years, unfortunately, it's been a constant fight to try to get more renewable energy, to try to allow people to aggregate solar power, for example, rather than every single person put solar power panels on the roof in order to get solar power. So this year, I've introduced a bill called the Local Choice Energy Act to allow cities, counties, tribes to be able to purchase energy from whoever they want. And that can mean that for a city like Las Cruces, we could go out and say, we want to purchase 80% solar power and or 100% solar power, and then allow the market to be able to compete and meet that demand. And what the 7 or 8 states that have done this have found is that when they have put this in place, communities end up getting cheaper energy, less expensive energy, and greener energy. And so this is really an energy revolution and an idea that's been talked about. I'm really excited to have introduced the bill with Senator Benny Shendo this session. Another interesting solar bill that I've also been working on for a few years is to get our state of New Mexico to do more solar power on our state buildings. The state of New Mexico owns over 750 buildings, and we only have solar power on 2 of them. And it's unbelievable the millions of dollars we can save if we do this. The state of New Mexico did a little study in the last 6 months on just our 25 buildings in Santa Fe that the state owns, and estimated that if we were to deploy solar power and energy efficiency improvements on those buildings, again, just the 25 in Santa Fe, we would actually save $25 million over 20 years.
Wow.
And that's on 25 buildings in Santa Fe. So this can be a massive cost savings and should be a massive initiative for the state. And so I am advancing that. That's important to the governor as well. Yeah. Stay tuned. And beyond that, working on lots of transparency, still fighting for full transparency of all lobbying activity in the state, all lobbying spending. Monday, I'll have a bill that's heard that will require lobbyists to report every bill that they lobby on and what their position was on the bill.
Yeah.
Right now, a lot of that work happens in the shadows, and New Mexicans really don't know the forces that are at work trying to pass or defeat a bill. And so this is all an attempt to bring our government all into the sunlight and so that we as citizens can fully see the mechanics of what's at work and the powers of influence, which will help level the playing field for us as citizens to be able to weigh in.
And, well, one of the things citizens did do, I'm sorry to interrupt, but was they voted for the establishment of an ethics commission. Now it's going to be up to the legislature to figure out how that's going to work. What are your thoughts on that?
That's something I'm very involved with as well, and I was the establishment of that constitutional amendment. It's going to happen this session. It has to. The citizens of the state passed a constitutional amendment on the ballot in November to establish this. We now have to pass an enabling act. The crucial thing there, Anthony, will be making sure that it is funded appropriately so that it has robust, investigatory resources to do its job. And that we give it the proper level of transparency so that when it's appropriate that, the records of these cases that are being adjudicated when there's probable cause that the public gets to see what's going on. And so I think those are really the two components of that will be the hole in the donut, as we say, how transparent it'll be and how well-funded it'll be. And there are people on different sides of the spectrum here in the Capitol that are more or less favorable on those provisions, and that's what we'll be fighting over, I'm sure.
Now, one of the things that may be a fight in the legislature this year is the raising of the minimum wage. Now, there's been a lot of support, of course, to raise the minimum wage to $10 an hour, eventually $12 an hour. But I'd like to hear your thoughts on what's the likelihood that that's going to happen during this 60-day legislative session.
We will raise the minimum wage this session. I believe that will happen. And that's happened in the past, and Governor Martinez vetoed that too. Granted, I think we raised it to $9 an hour at the time, but yeah, I think $10 an hour with a gradual increase, that's a proposal that seems to be have the most momentum. And I think there's a decent chance we will get that done. Hopefully we get that done. I mean, I don't want to water it down at all beyond that. You know, some folks would certainly like higher, but I think that's a good place for us to start in New Mexico. And of course, that would be equal with what we're doing in Las Cruces. So, you know, I think one debate has arisen around tipped wages and that credit. And we're hearing a lot of concerns from restaurants about that issue. And so we're continuing to process that. And so I'm sure we'll see adjustments to the proposal as it moves forward. But I feel good that we're going to get something done. Hopefully
so
meaningful.
How do you raise the minimum wage and avoid negatively impacting small businesses? I'd like to hear your thoughts on that.
No question about it. It has an impact on small business. And some small businesses that live on the margins do struggle with raising the minimum wage. I think it's a cost that, to some extent, gets passed on to consumers. And so but we have to understand the minimum wage was established back by FDR in the 1930s as really a wage to bring people out of poverty. And it's not meant to be a poverty wage that basically allows employers to subsidize our state's Medicaid program by paying desperate people really poverty-level wages. And so it's a balance act between, and to the extent that that concept of a minimum wage being a wage that somebody, if they work full-time, can not necessarily be on public assistance, or at least be able to provide for themselves without having to work 2-3 jobs in order to actually accomplish that. To the extent that we believe in that concept, then it's something that has to rise over time. And we see all other costs, including other business costs, go up with time, including the profitability of, frankly, a lot of industries. And wages must go up, too. And so the minimum wage has a role there. And at the same time, we should all understand and be sensitive to the fact that it definitely does have an impact on small business. Some can absorb it easier than others. And that is just something we need to be empathetic and try to support that as much as we can in any way that we can as well.
We just have a few minutes left, but I'd like to kind of get your thoughts on the atmosphere in Santa Fe right now. In the past few years, obviously, there's been a lot of fighting going on. There's been a lot of arguing, of course, limited resources regards to funds have been an issue. But there's been a lot of back and forth between the executive and the legislature. We've seen some special sessions. What are your thoughts right now with this new state legislature and new administration on how New Mexico is going to move forward?
First, it feels like a productive atmosphere. First and foremost, because it feels like we have a governor who's more interested in getting good results and moving New Mexico forward than kind of gotcha politics and just kind of almost punitive in her politics towards teachers, towards legislators. This governor, to her credit, has been very bipartisan, and she's had signing ceremonies already on bills that were vetoed by the last governor that she has signed already into law in her first 2 weeks from Republican legislators and had them up in her office. And I know that there's a lot of, enthusiasm, for lack of a better word, from some on the other side that were kind of worried about a governor from the other party coming into office. But there's legislators are trying to get things done. There's a lot of new blood, particularly in the House of Representatives, because that's the election that just occurred. The Senate is up this coming election.
Yeah.
And we see a lot of very bold proposals starting to move through the legislature that I personally am very excited about regarding our education, regarding our renewable energy future. I'm trying to work on a lot of exciting stuff, and the Senate's a little bit of a different animal.
Yeah. But I do want to let's talk about the Senate. We just have a couple minutes left, but I want to talk about a big issue. Obviously, education is a major issue. Sure. There's a lawsuit looming over the legislative session. It seems like a lot of the fight to funding education is going to go down in the Senate with the Senate Finance Committee. What are your thoughts on the Senate Finance Committee moving on possibly tapping the permanent fund to invest in early childhood education and education in general?
Yeah, I can't speak for the Senate Finance Committee.
But you know the Senate. You understand the Senate.
Yeah, no. And I understand that in the past that committee has been very opposed to, at least the majority of it, have been opposed, or at least the chair, opposed to, but not just the chair, tapping the permanent fund for early childhood education. So whether or not they change their mind on that, we'll just have to see. I don't have an indication at this point in time that they do, but I know that the advocates and the governor, I support that position, believe that we can afford to take, as the governor would say, a responsible pinch out of the permanent fund to fund early childhood. Here's the thing. We only fund
different estimates. We just got about 30 seconds left. Sorry, if you can.
Okay, we only fund up to maximum 30-40% of the eligible students in the state early childhood education that we were able to give them early childhood. So if we're going to say that we want all able kids in the state to have this, if we want to lift New Mexico out of poverty, we want to make generational investments, we have to fund that. And we know that given our budget instability, we can't count on that money out of the general fund. So making an investment from the permanent fund, as we did with it raising teacher salaries a decade ago, is a really smart idea. Hopefully we will get it done, and this will be part of our strategy and progress that we're able to make this session for the citizens of the state.
Okay, we are out of time. Senator Steinborn, thank you so much for making time to talk with us on Your Legislators, and we wish you the best of luck during this legislative session.
Thanks, Anthony. Thanks for the time.
And of course, we want to thank you for joining us for Your Legislators. You can always stay updated with legislative news anytime at our website, krwg.org. We're on social media as well. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. And you can email us your thoughts and also story ideas anytime. Just email us at feedback@nmsu.edu. I'm Anthony Moreno. We'll see you next time.